This is part 4 of square roots and radicals, and we're just going to continue doing more problems with multiplication, just some more examples. So here's the next one. Alright, so we have 2 square roots of 14 times 3 square roots of 21 minus 8 square roots of 35. None of those square roots can be simplified, and so I'm going to go right for the distributive property. But notice these are kind of big numbers inside the square roots when you multiply them together. So we're going to use our technique of leaving everything in factored form. That'll be easier. All right, so we're going to do the multiplication using the distributive property. So I have 2 square roots of 14 times 3 square roots of 21. I'm just going to go ahead and write that entire thing out for you. Minus 2 square roots of 14 times 8 square roots of 35. So if I'm going to do this first one, I've got 2 times 3, which is 6. But instead of doing 14 times 21, I'm going to look and see if they both happen to have a common factor. And they do. 7 goes into both of those. So I'm going to write 14 as 2 times 7, where the 7's second. And in the second number for 21, I'm going to write that as 7 times 3. So I'm just writing 14 times 21 in a factored form. In fact, this happens to be prime factorization, but it might not have been prime. 2 times 8 is 16, and same thing here. Do you see a common factor between 14 and 35? Also happens to be 7. So how about 2 times 7 times 35 is 7 times 5. So what can I do here? Well, for these two factors of 7, 1 7 pops out. And for these two factors of 7, 1 7 pops out. So I do have a little bit of arithmetic here. I've got 6 times 7, which is 42. Square roots of 6 minus 16 times 7, which is 112. And let's see, I've got 2 times 5, which is square root of 10. And can we combine those any further? Well, this has a square root of 10, that has a square root of 10. This has a square root of 6, the second one has a square root of 10, so they're not alike. I can't combine any further, and that's as far as we could go. All right, let's simplify this. 2 square roots of 3 minus square root of 5 times square root of 3 plus 3 square roots of 5. All right, let's do the FOIL method, because it's a binomial times a binomial. So I have 2 square roots of 3 times square roots of 3. So the 2 is on the outside. And then what about this square root of 3 times square root of 3? What's that going to give me? You don't have to say square root of 9, just good old 3. Okay, let's do the outer. 2 square roots of 3 times 3 square roots of 5. So I have the 2 times 3. That'll give me 6. And then I've got a square root of 3 times square root of 5. So we multiply those together to get a square root of 15. Inner. Square root of 5 times square root of 3. Nothing on the outside, so I have a minus sign. And multiplying 3 times 5 is 15. And now the last term, I have a minus times a plus, so it's a minus. On the outside is only a 3. And then I've got square root of 5 times square root of 5, which is 5. Now, of course, you can say, oh, it's square root of 25, but then, of course, square root of 25 is just 5. So what do we have here? 2 times 3 is 6. And, I've got 6 square root of 15 minus square root of 15. Remember, there's that invisible coefficient. So that's really 6 minus 1, because it's the same square root. So that's just going to give you plus 5 square roots of 15. Now, that does not mean 11 square roots of 15. 6 is all by itself. It's a whole number, and 5 square roots of 15 is like another animal. Minus the 3 times 5 is 15. Hey, there you go again. Look it. I've got a 6 and a minus 15. I could put those together. 6 minus 15 is negative 9 plus 5 square roots of 15. And do you have to write it like that? No. You can use the commutative property. If you want, you could write 5 square roots of 15 minus 9. But if you do that, make sure your minus sign is not underneath that square root. Both of those are acceptable ways of writing the same answer. You cannot combine it any further because the 9 does not have the square root of 15 with it. So be very careful. These are totally different things. How about this problem? 5 plus 2 square root of 7 squared. By the way, that doesn't mean you can't just square the first term and square the second term. It means 5 plus 2 square root of 7 times another 5 plus 2 square root of 7. So you could write it like that, or if you know the formula for squaring a binomial, you can do that as well. I think people make less mistakes by writing it out as 5 plus 2 square root of 7 times 5 plus 2 square root of 7. All right, let's do the FOIL method. So we have 5 times 5, which is 25. That's the first. Okay, outer. We're going to do the 5 times the 2 square root of 7. So I have the 5 times the 2 is on the outside, so that's 10 square root of 7. Then we're going to do the inner term, 2 square root of 7 times 5. So again, on the outside is the 2 times 5, 10 square root of 7. You know, anytime you're squaring a binomial, these two terms in the middle, the outer and the inner, will be exactly the same. Plus, now, the last term. 2 square root of 7 times 2 square root of 7. Well, 2 times 2 is 4, and square root of 7 times square root of 7 is 7. Okay, so 25 plus. Let's look over all the way at the end here. I've got 4 times 7. What's that add up to? 28. I'm going to write that here. And then I'm going to do these two terms because they're both alike. They both have square roots of 7. So I add their coefficients. So it's 20 square roots of 7. Okay, any like terms that I can add together here? Sure. The 25 and the 28. So that's 53 plus, and then I have 20 square roots of 7. You have to know when to stop, and here it is. You can't go any further because 53 is not the same like term as something with a square roots of 7 in it. All right, so there's your answer. Here's kind of a special one. 3 minus square roots of 5 times 3 plus square roots of 5. Do you recognize this at all from when you first started multiplying with binomials? Well, we'll come back to that later. Let's go ahead and just do the FOIL method. 3 times 3 is 9. And I do the outer. 3 times square root of 5 is plus 3 square roots of 5. And the inner term, well, the only difference is I have a minus sign, right? So it's going to be a minus 3 square roots of 5. And the last term, minus square root of 5 times plus square root of 5, that's going to be a minus. Square root of 5 times square root of 5 is just 5. All right, let's do the whole number parts first, or the integers, I should say. I have 9 minus 5. What's that add up to? 4. And then we have 3 square roots of 5 minus 3 square roots of 5. What's that? 0. I don't need to write 4 plus 0. So you know what? Isn't that pretty cool? When I multiplied those two binomials together that had a square root in them, I ended up with just the integer 4. No square roots at all. I was wondering if you might have noticed that kind of looks like a plus b times a minus b. Remember that? That's just a squared minus b squared. Let's do that problem by thinking of it as a squared minus b squared. A, in this case, would be your 3's, right? That's your a squared. 3 times 3 is 9 minus, okay, and what's your b? Your b in this case is your square root of 5 times square root of 5. Square root of 5 times square root of 5 is 5. 9 minus 5. Ooh, very cool. So I still get 4. So you would get the answer by going ahead and just crunching through it the way we did it originally using the FOIL method. Or if you recognize that the inner and outer term are always going to cancel when you have something of this form, a plus b times a minus b, you would just do 3 times 3 is 9 minus square root of 5 times square root of 5 is 5, and 9 minus 5 is 4. And we're going to be using this pretty extensively, actually, when we're doing some division with radicals, which is what's coming up.